Ba 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 ba.
Hi, I'm John DeBella. We're done.
John DeBella, this is OTN. These guys range from sophomores through seniors. OTN, this is John DeBella. He ranges from the 60s till now. He's got lots of great stuff from the 50s. Well, he's got lots of great stuff to tell you. He's going to give you a little idea about what his story is, how he got to where he's at. Take a sneaky suspicion that part of the reason that he's where he's at is he believes he can do it. That's just a guess, though. So once he's done, we're going to do a question and answer session. When that happens, make sure we're going to have somebody coming around, probably Britt Nettles, with a microphone. Don't ask the question until you have the microphone. That way we can hear it. So without further ado, Mr. John DeBella.
Thank you. Personally, I don't know about the rest of you, but I would like a little more ado. Everybody's always saying, without further ado, why are we limited on our ado? And we should get as much ado as we possibly can. And now, I'll try to make some sense. In all honesty, you guys probably put more prep into coming here today, just walking to this room, than I put into the speech. But then again, this is what I do for a living. Because I have found over the course of my career that I work better not being prepared. Because what it does is it makes me use all of my talents. It makes me use everything I've got going for me. And the thing that I got going for me more than anything else on the planet is I can talk forever. I am really lucky because during the course of my life, I have met other people who were like me, who maybe didn't have the opportunities that other people had. Right? And because of them, I got a leg up. Now, let me give you a little bit of history about me and basically bring you up to today. I was born in the 50s, which was a wonderful time to be alive because absolutely everything was new, right? You know, I went from one day their planes had propellers, to the next day planes were jets, to the next day man was on the moon. To live through that is a great experience. To watch all of that is a fantastic experience, right? So don't take, and I'm going to give you little lessons as we go along, don't take things that you see that is every day as every day, because everything, every piece of technology that you come across, everything that happens in every day of your life truly is special. Because what happens is you get caught up in so much of the da-da-da-da-da-da that you miss the little stuff. Don't ever miss the little stuff, because you're gonna find as you get older, the little stuff is more important than anything else in the world. When I was a kid, I don't know if they make you do this anymore. Did you take an aptitude test where they say to you, okay, you're gonna answer all these questions and we're gonna tell you what you're gonna be when you grow up? Did that happen to you anytime during the course of your life? Yeah, they told me to be a plumber. Yeah, basically they said, you know, you're not gonna be able to go on beyond a plumber. You should really learn a trade. You're not gonna go anywhere. And that was really, truly the greatest gift I got from the New York City Department of Education. Because the last thing you tell a young Sicilian kid is he can't do something. And that's really where my career started. Because upon being told that I couldn't do anything, and when I left high school, I had no grades. My grades were terrible. They were absolutely terrible. There was no reason that a college should take me. But I showed up at Hofstra University on Long Island, and I went into the admissions office, and basically, I knew nothing about it. Nobody prepped me. I didn't have a guidance counselor who said, here's how you prepare for college, here's how you apply. Nobody told me a thing. So I went out to Hofstra University, because I knew some guys who went there, some of my friends went to Hofstra, and I went into the admissions department and said, I'd like to go here. And the guy said, well, you have to put out an application, you have to do all this stuff. I said, okay, who do I talk to? So I go into this guy's office, and I have my records from high school with me, and he tells me that you can't get into this school. He says, you don't have the grades to get into this school. I said, look, I'm not even sure if I want to go here. The guy looks at me and says, wait, you're here? I said, yeah. I said, because, you see, I'm going to do something with my life. I'm going to, this is the God's honest truth. I am sitting in this guy's office, and I start to tell him that I'm going to do something with my life, and they could have the joy of being able to say that I went there for an 18-year-old kid at a university that he cannot get into. And the guy's looking at me like, what? And I said, yep. I said, because, you know, the day's going to come. Look, I'm gonna go out there. I'm going to become famous. Right? And you're going to want to tell people that I went here to get other people to go to the school. You're going to ask me for money every year. Right? As soon as I get famous, you're going to start sending me the letters and asking me for money. You're going to want me to donate a wing to the building. I got into the school. They actually let me in that January. Right? I had to wait to the spring semester. But I got in, and I got in on pure guts, and that's when I realized that, you know what, if you believe what it is that you can do it. And you know what? Not only did I become famous, I made the money, and I get the letters, and I make the donations. I don't have a wing anywhere there, but there is a studio at the college radio station that has my name on it. All right, that cost me a nice piece of change. All right, but literally, all of this because someone said no. No one, let no one ever get away with saying no. No one should ever stop you from doing anything. The only person who can stop you is you. When you don't believe in yourself, you fail. Now, I'm not saying you're going to succeed, right? You're going to fail and fail time and time again. But every time you fail, you learn that much more. Failure is a good thing, as long as you use it to your advantage. As long as you believe in you, you are going to go, it's going to work. But believe me, and I can't stress this enough, from junior high school through high school, and even in college, be a plumber. That's all they ever said was be a plumber. Every kid that I went to college with, who were the actors who were pushed to the side, or the technicians who were told, yeah, really not that talented. Every one of them are the ones who made it. Every one of them are the ones who didn't end up becoming waiters, didn't end up becoming more drama teachers, are the people who are working actors and directors today. A lot of the names you wouldn't know, but a lot of the character actors, especially a lot of them are character actors. If I started going through certain films, eventually I'll find a movie that you all know them in. But the reality is that we were all, and it wasn't just me alone, we were all these people who were told by others that we were not going to get anywhere, and the only people who believed in us was ourselves. And when you believe in yourself, nobody stops you. Things will stop you. Finance might stop you. Right? You know, and other people might make it difficult for you. You find a way to go around them. Like I said, with these TV shows that I'm producing now, right? Every time one fails, I've met four more producers. I've met five more, programming director, executives. I've met a lot more people, and if they liked what I had, the next time I show up, I have an easier time getting in the door. The steps are slow. I mean, I've been in the radio business longer than probably anybody in the school has been on the planet. Right? But here I am at 60 years old, and 5 years ago, I decided to start a new career while I was still in my career, and I'm succeeding at it. Right? Have I gotten anything on TV? No. Right? Will I? You bet. So that's basically a really as short as I could possibly make it story of me and who I am. I had nothing. I have everything I want now. I've got a son who's incredibly talented and is a recording producer out in LA. I've got a wife who is the most beautiful person on the planet. I've got an S load of cars and a really nice house. All of it because people told me no. Thanks. What's my favorite Beatles album? Probably it's not Sgt. Pepper's, right? It's not one that most people will jump out for, but it's probably Magical Mystery Tour. You know, because, well, you know what? Because there's so much George on Magical Mystery Tour, and I love George, right? And although Sgt. Pepper's was like, you know, wow, you know, I mean, it was a game changer record, right? If you had to ask me my favorite, it's Magical Mystery Tour. I have a number of them. My comedy comes from three people: Jonathan Winters, Danny Kaye, and Bill Cosby. Nobody taught me more about storytelling than Bill Cosby. I got to interview him about 2 or 3 months ago for the first time, but it was on the phone. And if he didn't grab control of the situation, I probably would have, even now, I get a little shaky about it. Because so much of who I am comes from him. I remember my mom telling me I would bring home a Bill Cosby album when it came out, and I would play it once, and I would have it memorized. And my mother was like, let me get this straight. You listen to this record one time, you can recite it, but you don't get math, you know? And they're teaching it to you every day. So as far as comedy is concerned, those are my influences. As far as radio is concerned, it's a guy in New York named Dan Ingram and another disc jockey named Jonathan Schwartz, right? And then when it comes to interviews, and really how to conduct an interview, it was a man named Jack Parr, who was the forerunner to Johnny Carson, who was the second. Johnny Carson was probably one of the greatest interviewers there ever was.
Most memorable experience of a person winning a ticket contest on your radio show?
I mean, look, I mean, every, you know, you get two types of people who really, well, three types of people, right, who win tickets on the show. You get the screaming maniac, right? Which all disc jockeys love. Everybody loves the screaming maniac, right? You get, cool, right? All disc jockeys hate them. And then you get just nice people who are like fun in between. What might be a more interesting story is my favorite phone call of all time. Back when I was at MMR, we were at 19th and Walnut Street, and right below the studios, and the studios had floor to ceiling windows. And right, so we could turn around while we were on the air and just see what was coming out on the street. And some guy had called up to the studio from the phone that was out there on the street. And the guy, he says, hi, is this John DeBella? I go, yeah. He says, you know, we're right here at 19th and Walnut Street. We'd really like to come up and see you guys. We want to be in the studio. I said, okay. I said, but we got some rules about being able to come up here. The guy goes, okay, what's that? And now I look out the window and I said, you got to be wearing jeans. I got jeans on. I said, okay, well, that's great. All right. And you got to have a baseball cap, right? And each time we're just looking out the window, right, to see what this guy looks like, right? You got to have a baseball cap. I got a baseball cap. And you hear one after another, no matter, we keep naming things, right, that he has. He can't see that we're just looking right down at him, right? Until eventually we ask him for something that he doesn't have. And you hear this like, oh no, I don't have a shopping bag or whatever it was that we asked him for, right? And the sound of that, people come up to me to this day asking about, remember the guy in the phone booth outside the studio? It was just one of those calls. I mean, I love it. I love it more than anything else. Because to this day, I can just hear this guy's, oh, no. But we must have asked him for like 9 different things. And he kept buying it. Like, you had to have this requirement. You have to have a t-shirt with a hole in it. I've got a hole in my t-shirt. You know? So that's my favorite.
About your DeBella the ball.
Okay.
What gave you the idea to do that?
Well, have you ever heard the expression the bell of the ball? No, you never did? Usually the bell of the ball would be the girl who showed up who was like, you know, the hot chick. She was like the one, right? And because my name was DeBella, we came up with, you know, the idea, okay, we'll just call it DeBella the ball. The object was I'm not a fan of exclusivity when it comes to my audience. I want everybody to, you know, experience as much as they can. If it's going to be fun, I want to have fun with them. I am not impressed with me. You know, I think, you know, I have a job. I talk on the radio. Other people drive trucks. Some people work in pharmacies. Some people are teachers. Some people are doctors. That's their job, right? I don't think that anybody in entertainment really should be held any higher than anyone else. So when it came time to do events, I always wanted to have as many of my listeners around as possible. So I decided that I should have a party. Stephen Starr, you know Stephen Starr who owns all the restaurants in Philadelphia? Back in the day, he was a club owner. He used to own this club on South Street called the Ripley. And we go over to his place, and I said, look, I want to have this party. I don't know how many people are going to show up. You know, give me a night that you're going to have whatever bands you're going to have on stage. Let all of my listeners in for free, and, you know, they'll buy drinks at your bar, and you'll have more people at your bar than you would have had on any other night. It's okay, and he starts looking through his calendar of what's coming up, and he gets to December 7th. Now, do you know why December 7th is famous? The day they bombed Pearl Harbor. So he says, well, December 7th's open. I said, fantastic, the day which will live in infamy, right? Because that's what the president said at the time. Right? And he says, wait, you want to throw a party on December 7th? I said, yeah. I said, perfect. You've got it. It's wide. It was a Tuesday night. It's wide open. Literally about a massive 30 people showed up for the first DeBella DeBall. Right? The following year, 1,200 people showed up. The year after that, there's no ballroom in Philadelphia that can hold more than 2,000 people. That's the largest ballroom the city has. And we handed out tickets for 2,000 people, and someone bootlegged them. So 2,000 people had real tickets, and another 3,000 or 4,000 people had bootleg ones. 6,000 people showed up to get into a room that only 2,000 people could get into. And I had to address 4,000 some odd people and tell them, yours a phony.
What was the highlight of your career so far?
I had a girl one time, little girl, maybe about 6 years old, 7 at most, at a Christmas party I threw for underprivileged kids. And I'm walking around and we're doing this thing and I see this girl, she's adorable. She's got these pigtails with all little Bowie things in it. And, right? I mean, millions of them. Right? And I said, hi, how you doing? She said, fine. I said, you having fun today? She says, yeah. I said, what do you want for Christmas? She says, a Happy Meal. Wow, I said, a Happy Meal? So you get a Happy Meal anytime. Why would you want a Happy Meal? I said, I never had one. Now, to hear that from a 6-year-old in 1989-90 was really shocking to me. Went on the air the next day and told people the story. Kid didn't really have all that much. And I asked the listeners, I said, what can we do for this kid? All she wants is a Happy Meal. Think of all of the things she could have asked for. What she wants is a Happy Meal. I had, in a week's time, more toys than you could fill the stage with. Bicycles and, you know, little kids' make-believe kitchens and stuff like that. So when I look back at my career, the things that really mean the most to me are the effects I had on small, little things that everyone will forget about. I mean, because I can meet the rock stars, I can talk to the rock stars, I can do it, and dude, it was great. It was fantastic, right? But, I mean, I went fishing with David Bowie. How many people can say that? But if I had to remember only one thing, showing up at that kid's house the next day to be able to, and I asked the father, I said, here's all I want to do, right? Peek through the window when she saw this. And I went to her house in West Philly, and her father knew I was going to be there, and I literally looked in the window of the house and watched this little kid freaking out. Nothing in my life means more to me than that. That's, you know, if I can help a single person, if I can make one person's day better, I'm winning points with God. That's really about it. All right? I'm sorry if I didn't directly answer your question, but that's really what means the most to me.
The skill for storytelling. Like, how did you develop that skill and when did it come in most handy?
Probably the first time it came in the most handy is when I showed up at Hofstra and started to explain why I should be there. But I developed it by Danny Kaye and Jonathan Winters. Danny Kaye was a singer, actor who has been in a lot of great movies from the late 40s and through the early 50s, even into the 60s. Right? Jonathan Winters was a comedian who was truly out of his mind, and he would become all of these characters, and he was really great at working ad lib. He could just work off the top of his head. He was so nuts that he actually had himself committed for a couple of months every few years. Right? This man was nuts. But Cosby, and listening to Bill Cosby and the way Bill Cosby didn't tell jokes. Everything, a short Bill Cosby cut on one of his albums was 3 or 4 minutes long, and it was just a story. And I learned through listening to that it's like, listen to guys after they win the Super Bowl. As great as it is to win that game, when you start to ask them about it, why did they break down? Why do guys cry at the end of major sporting events? It's because the journey. It was the journey. It was everything that got them to that point that made it really. So it's not the win, it's the journey, and that's really, you know, so Cosby and the stories, that's where I learned it's not the punchline, it's not the end of the thing, it's getting people to the punchline. And that's how it became important to me, and really that's what I learned from.
What was the biggest obstacle in your career, your life, and how did you get through it?
The biggest obstacle for me to come over was my speech. I have a stammer. When a lot of it comes from the fact that I'm thinking so fast and I can't get the thoughts from my head to my mouth and out. So a lot of times I will, because I'm thinking and I'm trying to get to where I'm going to get to next.
If you're on radio every day for the past years, what happens when you lose your voice or suddenly you get strep throat, you can't talk?
There's only two things that keep me off the radio. One is that I really have no voice. I've gone in, right, and people will call and go home, right? Because my voice would sound terrible, right? But I've never had laryngitis to the point that I couldn't speak at all. I've had like really raspy throat and sore throat and all that stuff, but never that bad.
Give us a day in the life of John DeBella. Wake up, what do you do till the end?
Let's take, not a Friday. Let's take a weekday. Fridays kind of change. Fridays are different. My alarm goes off at 3 a.m. I truly bounce off the walls. I get up earlier than I need to because I don't want to run out because it doesn't put your head in the right place. So I'm willing to get up earlier. I don't need to get up until 3:30 and still be able to have the pace. So as long as I'm up between 3 and 3:30, I'm fine. All right. I truly do bounce off the walls. I leave my bedroom, I head downstairs to the kitchen, and I bang into things and I fall over stuff. And I've got a automatic coffee maker and the coffee is ready. And I come upstairs and I get in the shower and I get dressed. I do a bunch of exercises in the morning because I'm a cripple and I can't stand up straight for very long periods of time. And then by 4 a.m. I am in my car and I drive to the radio station. The radio station is about 12 minutes away, so by 4:15 I'm sitting at my desk and I am reading. There's an initial 6 different websites that I read. 2 newspapers, and then 4 prep services. Basically, what I'm looking for is, all right, what's everybody talking about? What's the consistent thing that's going through all of these things? From the newspapers, I'm going to get the local angle, right? From the press services, I'm going to get the national angle, and for my prep services, I'm going to get the quirk. So, and then decide, okay, what are we going to do where? Because I've got all of these breaks that I've got to fill in. By 5 o'clock, my producer's in by 4:30. By 5 o'clock, the rest of my staff is there. And now we're kicking stories around. And I'm still doing my prep, and then they're shouting out stories. What do you think about this? Is this something we talk about. Can we get that guy on the phone? What can we do? Blah, blah, blah. Who's the interview today? Who's calling in? This, that, and the other thing. It's all plotted out, you know, for the most part before we leave the day before. We fill in the holes, we go in, we do the show. On your side of the radio, it's really easy. It's we sit around for 5 to 10 minutes, the music stops, we tell you the weather, we say something stupid and play 5 commercials, right? On our side of the radio, it does not stop. Doing radio is even harder than doing television, because radio doesn't stop. It is constant. The music, you know, someone's got to make sure that the next record gets on the air. Someone's got to calculate, because I've got a break at 7:05. So before I pick that next record, I got to make sure that the record that I'm picking is going to get me out at 7:05, because if I haven't get out at 7:06, the 4 songs I'm going to play after that are going to run late too, and every time I run late, it backs up the whole show. And if I get to a spot where, like this morning, you know, Ralphie May is supposed to call in at 8:10, at 8:09, he's going to be on the show. He's not going to sit on the phone for 4 minutes because I'm running late. So it is a constant math problem. Right? And making sure that all of that is, you know, that you're playing the right things and you're dropping the right things in. We're answering the phones. We're doing contests. When sometimes something will happen in the spur of the moment. All right, it's 9 o'clock. Show's over with. We leave. Now we start the beginnings of the next day and maybe the next week's shows, because anybody who's calling in from LA doesn't do them live. At 9 o'clock in the morning, it's 6 o'clock in the morning in LA. And as much as I would like to talk to Snooki or whoever that, you know, might be calling in, if they're in LA, they don't want to get up at, you know, 3 or 4 in the morning in order to be on the radio live. So a lot of West Coast stuff we pre-record. So we'll record that stuff. And by 11 o'clock, we're usually done with that. We're doing promos for the next day. I'm in meetings with advertisers and with salespeople who believe that their idea is just brilliant, right? You know, and it only works for them. It doesn't work for the audience. It doesn't work for the show. It doesn't work for ratings, but it definitely helps them make a sale. So you have to, you know, sort of politicize yourself through all of that. And by about 12 o'clock, the show is to bed, at least what we think the show is going to be the next day, because we want to walk out knowing that if nothing happens in the world, we have this show to rely on, that we have something to do tomorrow. I now go home and have some lunch. Sometimes I go to the gym and then have some lunch. Right? But once I'm home, and I'm usually home between 12 and 1:30, now I start working on future shows, maybe edit the interview that we did from the West Coast. I don't trust people to edit my interviews. Although I have a staff of people who could all do it well, I do it better, so I want to do it myself. I do a video piece for the station's website called the Classic Rock Update, and I assemble that and go out and look for news stories, go out and look for video on these people. Right, with classic rock artists, it's really hard to find a lot of early video because, well, there wasn't any. So I'll do that. I'll write. I'll work on these TV projects of mine. Right, you know, if it was only just on an iPad, I could show you what some of my shows look like, but I only have an iPad, and this many people holding it like this is going to be really kind of boring. Right, but then at 6 o'clock, dinner's ready, and I sit in the kitchen with my wife and our dogs and watch the news, and sit there from like 6 to 7, and at 7 o'clock, as soon as Brian Williams says, good night, please come back tomorrow, I go upstairs, I get my clothes together for the next morning because I don't want to try to pick out clothes at 3:30 in the morning. I'll really look like a clown. Get into bed. Either watch live TV or whatever's on the DVR, and by 9 o'clock I'm asleep, and then it starts all over again. That's my day.